the individual. So in that case, we shall only talk about the event horizon, so we are not talking about the apparent horizon, because they are identical. So for the specialized approach, we cannot distinguish all these features, we only consider the event horizon. But in the dynamical situation, that I shall talk about, that where the space-time metric have time-dependent metric elements. So there, in the dynamical situation, that is always distinct from the event horizon, and not only that, the apparent horizon is always within the event horizon. So that will always be inside the black hole. And some energy conditions is there. Now, the presence of these trapped surfaces inside the black hole gives the formation of the singularity. Singularity means, so they are converging, to some point. So that points are the points of singularity. And those singularities are identified by Penrose alone and then in collaboration with Stephen Hawking. So those are known as the Penrose and Hawking singularity theory. And we should once mention that singularity means that if in the space-time there is assumption that there should be geodesic incompleteness. Geodesic incompleteness means if I have a singularity in the space-time, then if I consider the geodesics, the family of geodesics from any point in the space-time, I can see that mathematically, I can see that there are some geodesics that cannot go for all values of the apparent time. Because geodesics are different, the differential equation characterizing the geodesic, they are characterized by some affine parameters. And that affine parameter can take any real value. So you can see that if you have a singularity in the space-time, then that geodesics cannot be true for some particular value of the affine parameter. So that is termed as the geodesic incompleteness. Because I cannot complete the geodesic because for that particular value of the affine parameter, I cannot define the geodesic. So that is the geodesic incompleteness. So if you have the geodesic incompleteness, that always means that you have singularity there. So that is the criteria that is defined by Penrose and Hawking. And they have defined this in that way. Now first of all, the first conjecture in that way was given by Penrose. And according to Penrose, in some energy conditions are satisfied, and according to Penrose, that is the non-energy condition. That should be satisfied, but later in collaboration with the Hawking, he has shown that even if the strong energy conditions are satisfied, then also they have some theorems related to singularity. Also there are some technical assumptions that there, I am not mentioning it. But I will talk about these energy conditions just I am coming, because I am coming to the Roy-Chowdhury equation, from which, because basically they have formulated those energy conditions and those theorems, singularity theorem, using those Roy-Chowdhury equations. So I am just giving you what they are, how they are formulated it. Okay, but the nature of singularity predicted by the theorem is rather vague. That means that they have formulated the singularity theorem, but they have not shown, but they have not predicted whether that singularity will be inside the black hole or it will be totally visible by any observer. So that has not mentioned by that, and that is known as the incompleteness of those theorems. Because they have shown that if there is geodesic incompleteness with certain restrictions, then we must have the singularity. But they have not mentioned when that singularity will be covered by the event horizon, that means that is the inside of the black hole, or it will be nakedly visible. So that is not mentioned there, but later Penrose has given a conjecture, that is, they have not proved that will be always covered, that singularity is not be naked. But that is a conjecture, and there are several theoretical examples where we have shown that singularity may be naked in nature. But in any case, now I am coming to the stationary black holes. So in 1972, Hawking showed that if the black hole is stationary, then there is only two possibilities. Either it may be static or it may be axiomatic. So all stationary black holes can be characterized in that way, either it is static or it is axially symmetric. So static black holes, there will be the spherically symmetric black holes, and otherwise it will be axially symmetric. Now, if I have the rotating black holes, then that will be surely axially symmetric, and it admits Killing vectors. Killing vectors means, I loosely speaking, the Killing vectors means it indicates some symmetry of the space-time. And how you can identify it? The definition is like this. If in the space-time I have the metric like this, if I have the vector jar, and if I have the metric, the lead derivative of the metric with respect to that vector field is zero, then we say that this vector field jar is the Killing vector field of that space-time which is characterized by this method. Okay, it is the formal definition. What it means? Now, more rigorously, if I do the derivative directly, you can find out like this. This is equal to zero. This is the semicolon means the covariance. So that is equal to zero, so that is the mathematical formula. And another way, you can determine the Killing vector if the metric coefficient, G mean U, is independent of some space-time coordinate. Suppose all the metric coefficients G mean U are independent of a particular coordinate XL, then the tangent vector along that is del del XL, that will be Killing vector. See, it is normally like this. Now, if I have the axisymmetric space-time, so it is the rotating black hole, then that, as it is stationary, so it is, all the metric coefficients should be independent of the time coordinate. And as it is axisymmetric, all the metric coefficients should be independent of the azimuthal angle phi. So the polar coordinate phi, it should be independent of this. So the metric should be independent of t and phi. So if the metric is independent of t, then we call that this t alpha, which is actually del del t, and phi alpha, which is del del phi, they should be the Killing vectors. Because all the metric coefficients are independent of the t coordinate and phi coordinate. So there should be two Killing vectors, one is t alpha and phi alpha. So if I now consider a linear combination of t alpha and phi alpha, so that I define as Xi alpha. So Xi alpha is also a Killing vector. And what is omega h? Omega is nothing but the angular velocity of the rotation of the black hole. And here I have just mentioned, if omega is 0, it is non-rotating, so it is static. So now I shall say that event horizon is a Killing horizon. Here event horizon will also be the Killing horizon in this case, for this particular case. And here, this Xi alpha will be tangent to the horizon's non-zero. So we know that event horizon is a null hypersurface, and that null hypersurface is characterized by the null generator, and this Xi alpha, which is the Killing vector, that Killing vector will be tangent to those horizon's non-zero. That we have shown by the object. Now, if I consider these generators, and they are parametrized by, I am not talking about more details like this, so any displacement along that generator will be characterized by like this, where V is the advanced time coordinate. Now I am talking about the surface gravity. And here I shall mention that how you deduce the surface gravity, that I shall again discuss in the next lecture, but I briefly give about the surface gravity. Now in terms of the Killing vector, I am talking about the surface gravity. Now if you know that Xi alpha is some tangent vector to some geodesic. If I have the geodesic, then geodesic means that the tangent vector will be always along the, or rather the velocity of a particle will always be along the tangent to the geodesic. Now what do you mean by this? Here Xi alpha is suppose any vector, and this means that this is the intrinsic derivative of that Xi alpha, displacement vector. So intrinsic derivative means it is the velocity, and velocity is proportional to the tangent vector. I just give you this. This Xi alpha covariant beta into Xi beta, that I can loosely write as Xi alpha dt. That is the intrinsic derivative. I think you know about the intrinsic derivative. In tensor calculus, whenever you are talking about the differentiation, in most of the time we talk about the covariant derivative, because partial derivative no longer gives the tensor to a tensor. But if I talk about the covariant derivative, that always gives us a tensor. If I make a covariant differentiation of a tensor, that gives us a tensor. But there is one difference is that if I differentiate, covariant differentiate a one zero tensor, then after covariant differentiation it becomes a 1-1 tensor. So the rank of the tensor is changed after the covariant differentiation. So, but normally we know normally in the Euclidean geometry, suppose I have a vector, I differentiate. I differentiate means I have the position vector. I differentiate, I get the velocity. I differentiate the velocity vector, I get the acceleration. Then in tensor, I will get that I have a position vector. So if I differentiate, I differentiate means I differentiate the covariant vector. So I can get a 1-1 tensor. So velocity is a vector, so it cannot be a 1-1 tensor. So how I can get the velocity vector and the acceleration vector? So that notion is given by the intrinsic derivative. Intrinsic derivative is obtained from the covariant derivative in that way. Covariant derivative with this partial derivative, if I make the contraction, I get the intrinsic derivative. And the intrinsic derivative is the property where after differentiation, the rank of the tensor remains unchanged. So whenever I take the intrinsic derivative of the position vector, I get the velocity vector. If I take the intrinsic derivative of the velocity vector, I get the acceleration vector. So that should be clear here. So that's why it is the tangent vector, or that it is rather the velocity vector. So velocity vector is proportional to the tangent vector, or the position vector, like this. So velocity vector is always proportional to the tangent vector, means it is the geodesy. And this is the proportionality factor kappa. And that proportionality factor kappa is identified as the surface gravity of the planet. So I will give the formal definition and how we can derive that, that we will give later. But here, just for the completeness, I shall give the definition of the surface gravity. And normally, according to the Dacron laws, the surface gravity is constant over the event horizon. So it is constant along the horizon generator, and it is uniform over the entire horizon. Now if kappa is non-zero, then we say that the horizon, it is a formal definition that it is geodesically complete. That means that geodesically complete means that the as I have mentioned earlier, that generators may leave the horizon in the past, but if it is geodesically complete, it never leaves the horizon. It always remains within the horizon. And whenever I have a two surface where this Xi alpha equal to zero, that is known as the bifurcation two-scale. It is some sort of dynamical analysis like this. So I am just not mentioning that. So now I am talking about the Roy-Chaudhury equation. So that is the Roy-Chaudhury equation. Here theta is the expansion of theta. If theta is positive, means that the congruence of geodesic is expanding, that means it is going diverging. And if theta is negative, this means that area is cross-sectional area is gradually decreasing, so it is contracting. So sine of theta gives us whether the congruence of geodesic is diverging or it is contracting. So that is given by this. So Roy-Chaudhury has given that, and here sigma is the shear tensor, and this R alpha beta is the Ricci tensor, and here Xi alpha, if I written in that way, so Xi alpha is a null vector. And if Xi alpha is a time-like vector, then there will be minus 1 sign. So the Roy-Chaudhury equation we can write either for the time-like curves or for the null curves. And this half means I am writing it for the null curves. If it is minus 1 sign, then it is for the time-like curves. So here I have written for null curves. So this Roy-Chaudhury, Professor Aman Kumar Roy-Chaudhury has derived this equation. And from using this equation, Hawking and Penrose have derived those singularity theorems. And this is a very famous equation. If you see any book of general relativity, where you always see this equation, because it is a very, very important equation which has a lot of significance. And from here, how they have derived the singularity theorems? You know that if you have the Einstein equation, so I am just giving you briefly. I just write kappa T mu. Okay, so this is my Einstein equation. So if I consider R mu nu, so I can write it as T mu nu minus half T. I am not giving this because I contacted with G mu nu, and from there I can find out the value of R. R will be minus T, and it turns out to be like this. R will be T, and here we can write. So R mu nu I can express like this. Now here I have R alpha beta gi alpha gi beta. So R alpha beta gi alpha gi beta. So this means that kappa into T alpha beta minus half T G alpha beta into gi alpha gi beta. So that I can write as kappa into T alpha beta gi alpha gi beta minus half T G alpha beta gi alpha gi beta. Okay, very simply I can write. Now you see that this is gi beta, this is norm of that vector. Now if gi alpha is the null vector, so by definition norm of that vector is zero. So whenever it is the null vector, so this is zero. So I have only T alpha, gi beta. So instead of this R alpha, gi beta, I can replace it by T alpha, gi beta. Okay? Now you note that in the right hand side, theta square is positive term, so there is a minus sign. So it is negative. Sigma alpha beta is the norm of the CR tensor. So it is always positive. So there is a minus sign. So that is negative. Now, if T alpha beta gi alpha, because I can replace R alpha beta gi beta by T alpha gi beta. Now, if this is positive, then all terms in the right hand side are negative. So d theta d term is negative. So this means that theta is decreasing. So area is gradually decreasing. So this means that the congruence of geodesic is gradually converging. Converging means it converging to where? It converging to some point. So it leads to some singularity. Okay. So only condition is that T alpha, gi beta should be positive. So T alpha, gi beta should be positive. That is nothing but the null energy condition. So Hawking Penrose just used in that way. So if that is positive, that always means that we are leading to the singularity. So if that I have a congruence of null geodesic, and if the energy condition, if the null energy condition is satisfied, then the congruence of geodesic is always converging. So in that context, I just mentioned the recent observation shows that our universe is expanding. Okay, so why they are saying that our universe is expanding? So expanding means that I have two astrophysical objects. So if I observe today and if I observe tomorrow, I can see that the distance between them is gradually becoming increasing. So that means the universe is expanding. And that also you can explain from here. So here, if for the null geodesics, I have this is, so if the null energy condition is satisfied, then I have that theta is decreasing. Okay. Now, instead of the null geodesic, if I now consider the time-like geodesic, then R alpha beta is replaced by all this. So this is T alpha beta minus half T G alpha beta into this. And that is nothing but the strong energy. So if the strong energy condition is satisfied, then theta will be decreasing. And theta decreasing means it is contracting. From where I am getting the contraction? It is getting the contraction due to the strong, thus meaning, due to the strong gravitational pull of the gravity. So gravity is dominating there. And that's why you know that in standard cosmology, people are saying that if the matter satisfies the strong energy condition, then we cannot have the acceleration observed by the observations. So if it is violated, then only there is some external force which can overcome this. Okay, so I going deviating much. So that is the Roy-Chaudhury equation. Now from here, there is a famous theorem of Frobenius theorem in the differential geometry. If I have the congruence of geodesic which are orthogonal to the null hypersurface, then the rotation vector should be zero. That's why I have in the Roy-Chaudhury equation, I have not written the rotation term. And due to stationarity, theta and d theta d theta lambda both will be zero. And using same in the Einstein equation and the null energy condition, this will be equal to zero on that event horizon. So there is no flow of the matter, and also sigma equal to zero. So now I am coming. If the black hole is the static black hole, then and it must be spherically symmetric, and the only possible solution is the Schwarzschild. And that is root, and you know the Bekov's theorem also. Bekov's theorem also states that if I have a static spherically symmetric vacuum solution, then only Schwarzschild solution is the only possible solution. And in that sense, the same thing, angular momentum, the complete gravity, if I consider the collapse of a star, then that will always lead to the Schwarzschild vacuum. Now I am just specifying, if I have the non-spherical star, then those asymmetry that will either die out to the infinity or it will be inside the black hole. And if it is axially symmetric, previously I have shown, if it is spherically symmetric, it must be Schwarzschild. If it is axially symmetric, then it must be Karp black hole. Now if there is a charge in the black hole, then this will be a Leisner-Nordström black hole. And if it is charged in the axially symmetric, then this is the Kahn-Newman black hole. Now, I have this famous statement by John Wheeler that a black hole can uniquely be characterized by only three parameters. The three parameters are its mass, its charge, and its angular momentum. And that is nicely phrased by John Wheeler that a black hole has no gear. So, only I can have four types of black holes: Schwarzschild black hole, Leisner-Nordström black hole, Karp black hole, or Kahn-Newman black hole. So these are the four types of black hole for the special model. Now I am coming about the defects of the event horizon. So we are talking about the stationary black holes, and they are characterized by the event horizon, but event horizon has some defects. The event horizon is a it is a universal property, and it cannot never be observed in finite time. Why it can never be observed in finite time? Because you can see that even for the Friedland case, the event horizon, radius of the event horizon, that is defined as some a to infinity dt by a, or rather some t to infinity present time, to, or I can write it as t0 to infinity. So that improper integral is not always convergent, and as I have to go to up to proper limit up to infinity, so it can not be observed in finite time, and its can location can only be observed in infinite future. And Hayward has shown that the event horizon does not exist and cannot have any physical event. And it may be such that the event horizon is passing through an observer, but it has no physical effect. So one cannot notice it at all. So we have to think over some other event except the event horizon. And as I have mentioned earlier, that event horizon only exists in a space-time if it is asymptotically flat. Other asymptotically flat means if I make r goes to infinity, the space-time reduces to infinity. So that is not true every time. So then a new idea comes, and that is known as the trap surfaces, and that is the trapping. So I just keep a few things. I just give you the flavor about the trapping surfaces. Yes, I just give you